Fenway Park. And now your host, Odell.
Welcome, Ray fans, to the fastest show on Inside Cable Channel 5. Yes, you're watching the... And I am your host, Odell Turner. Well, the next... bringing you some exciting racing. We're going to start off, we'll talk about the race event this week, what's on schedule. We're going to have a very special guest, a local drag racing. He is right now, although we told you last week who it is, so if you just listen, you already know. Now, without anything else being said, let's go pay some bills and hear some words from our good sponsor, Beach Bend Park.
Beach Bend Raceway Park. There's camping, picnic areas, swimming, water slides, ride, and the Kentucky Rumbler roller coaster. Drags and stock car racing. Why leave Bowling Green to go on vacation when you can go on vacation right here and have a blast? Come on out and visit us at Beach Bend. Be sure and get your season passes.
Okay. Now, before we give way to our guest, I do want to say I appreciate the kind words from Beach Bend and appreciate them sponsors. And we do need your help. If you can send in information, a request, wanting to know how much it is to sponsor a show, we'd be glad to get back with you. We're looking for sponsors. It can be your employment, your job. Can be your race team or whatever you want to do. We'll talk to you about sponsoring that show. It's very inexpensive. And also, we said last week on the show, if you're listening to our show, please email us or send us a stamped letter letting us know if you can't, you don't have email, and let us know you're watching our show, because we don't have a way to really know whether you're watching the show or not. Now, let's go right now and hear some great words from our special guest, Mr. Big Earl Talley. Hey, folks, as we talked earlier in the show, we got a great honor here tonight to have one of, I guess he's kind of a legend in the Beach Bend's local guys out here. We have a lot of the NHR guys come in, but on the local stuff, we've got a guy here. I'm going to let him tell you his name, and Earl, we appreciate you being on the show. Tell him your name and where you're from.
Earl Talley. I'm from here in Bowling Green. Lived here all my whole life, so I've been racing out here since probably roughly 95, pretty regular every weekend.
And now, what I was going to tell you, he said his name is Earl Talley, but if you're out here at the drag races, you know him more by Big Earl. That's what they call it. Now, I want to ask you that question. Where did you get that name, Big Earl?
Well, I mean, I've lost a little weight, but at one time I was about 280 pounds, so.
Hey, watch out about that now. I'm still there, about 280. I'm there now.
I ain't far from.
So does that mean I'm Big Odell, I guess?
Yeah, I don't know why, but I guess Big Earl just rings, and yeah. That's just, it's stuck.
You
know?
I thought maybe it's because you was kind of, you win a lot out here, and they just like you the big dog.
I have spells. I go on weekend. I can't do no wrong. Then like today, I can't do nothing right. So, you know, just like everybody else, I'm human.
And let's talk about that a little bit. Talking about not doing anything wrong or doing anything right. Last night in the O'Reilly shootout, unfortunately, a lot of times in drag racing, I come from the oval track, which most everybody knows, and there's a lot of repair work, a lot of motors blowed, and a lot of things happen in the oval track. In the drag tracks, fortunately, most of the time, there's not a whole lot of that going on, but from time to time they do, which brings us into this thing here. What happened last night out there? I seen you get on the line, I heard a pop, seen a car stop just past the tree. What happened?
Well, as you know, in drag racing, it's all about sticking the car, you know, traction.
You stuck too much.
I stuck it too good, you know, it just ripped the teeth off a ring gear and pin. You know, it's simple, but at the same time, it's just more work. But yeah, usually it's a maintenance-free car, you know.
And it is a little work involved there, but The more probably, and I'm maybe putting words in your mouth, but I'll ask you, I guess in my opinion, I think it probably the more frustrating thing of just not being able to race that, missing that pass, and maybe not getting finished out tonight. The work is bad, but that comes along with the territory, right?
Yeah, that's correct. You know, it's bad to have to work on, but yeah, I was still in another class. I was in the finals of one class, and I broke it in another class, so therefore I couldn't run the other class. So yeah, that was kind of frustrating, but at the same time, you know, you just take it in stride and move on.
Now, let me ask you this. You said you'd been dragging for a long time. I don't believe you said this, but when did you start first drag racing, and how old were you when you, and tell me just a little brief thing, your remembrance of your first time to ever make a pass.
I can't tell you the exact year, but it was probably early 90s, 91, 92, when I actually made my first pass. And I come out here in a car that run maybe 1750s, you know. And
watch out again. That's where I'm about at now.
Well, I mean.
Talking about me being big. Now he's talking about my slow car.
Well, you know, to me, on the street, I thought I had the fastest car on the road until I come out here and found out, no, I don't have the fastest car. But, you know, it just evolved from there. So.
It is different, and I'm just playing with you. You know, when I first came out here, I kind of thought I had a fairly decent car. And the first time I run on the O'Reilly's, I had a pickup truck. He was like an 11-second truck. And I got almost to the end, and I thought, well, I believe I got this. Because I looked in my mirror, and he was just like barely taking off. Next thing I know, he said, whoo. He went past me and beat me. And I'm like, how in the world did he do that? You know, it's amazing. I mean, and I know you've done this many times, but it's amazing to be almost there and somebody pass you by. And it seemed like I only got like 10 foot to do it in.
Yeah.
And they do it. I mean,
well,
it's amazing.
You know, that's the nature of it, handicap racing. You know, of course, it's bracket racing, as they call it, but it's handicap racing. Slower cars get to head start. Theoretically, if you both have perfect lights and you both run you dead on with a zero, you're going to cross finish line at exact same thousands of a second.
Right.
So, you know, it goes back to reaction time. If I've got you by 50 thou, then obviously I should get there 50 thou first, which is about 4 foot or so.
And we're talking about, while I go off the camera, about drag racing being a game of numbers. Now, when they talk about a guy beat or coming off the line, even it still triple zero, just 0-0-1. That's 1/1000 of a second,
that's
right?
Actually, 1/10000. Yeah. See, the first number would be the thousands. Yeah.
Okay. 1/10000 of a second. So that's kind of like a blink of an eye, or maybe quicker. Here.
Yeah, it's quicker than a blink of an eye. I think a blink of an eye is like almost 7 or 8 thousandths of a second. So
we're talking about, I mean, you get beat off that much distance. I don't know what that would be. As far as if both of you, if he took off like that and you took off that, if he took off 0-0-0,
yeah,
he took off 0-0-1, how much distance that'd be on track. But that definitely, if he was running the same speed, would beat you.
Well, yeah. You know, I have lost races. The finish line stripe be .0000. Of course, the computer's going to break it down to a million a second. It's going to pick a winner. But, I mean, literally, y'all cross the finish line, you know, side of eye, you won't never pick a winner. You know, the computer had to do it.
Now, that brings me to another question. Since you drove so long and you've won a lot of races out here, and I'm trying to learn all this stuff. So part of my show, part of my advantage is to get you guys to tell me the secrets, see, so I can beat you someday. How in the world do you ever adjust? Because now, the breakout thing, that's what's driving me crazy. Writing your dial in time, I'm beating myself. Last 3 times I beat my own self by breaking out. Now, I see these guys get down towards the line and they'll hit their brakes or let off the gas to try not to break out. I'm trying to figure out how they know to even do it, because I'm like, you know, I'm afraid to even do it.
It's practice. It's years of doing it. But what you do, you know, you just learn where that car is supposed to be, and you watch him. You know, the finish line's here, and if he's still 3 car lengths behind you, and you're obviously going to get there first, then obviously you want to hit the brakes. You just got to learn to judge how fast he's coming up on you or how fast you're coming up on him.
Now, I play music a little bit. Not real good at it, but I play. To me, when I look back and see a car coming, I have a hard time is coming, so if I hit my brakes, I'd probably mess up and let him win. Anyway, so that's what I'm saying. It's kind of like it's a really an art, isn't it? I mean,
yeah.
You have to learn how to see how fast you're coming by looking backwards.
Well, that's part of it. There's guys out here that's obviously better at driving the finish line than they are at the starting line, but it just takes years of practice. And of course, if you're in the same car, pass after pass after pass, then you can learn, like, you know, at the 1/8 mile, hey, this guy here is 3 car lengths further back than where he should be. I'm getting there first. You know it.
Well, I'm going to ask you 2 questions before I forget it. And one of them is, what do you think you do the best coming off line at the finish? Where do you think? Hold that thought right there. And the second thing, let's remember this. I want to talk about your car first. You got one of the most unique cars out here. And there's
different.
A story behind that, because I understand that you got that off eBay. Tell them a little bit about, of course, you do have another car that you drag too, and you may have more than that, but I know you got two. But tell them about this wagon that you drive.
It's a 69 Buick Sport Wagon, station wagon. It's got the glass roof, which is like an Oldsmobile Vista Cruiser roof. Buick calls it a Skyliner roof. It's basically a stock bodied car. I've got a stock 455 Buick motor in it. It's nothing special, you know.
It looks like nothing really out here. Well, I mean, it's kind of, like I said, it's a unique car.
Well, you know the rat rods is in style right now.
That's right.
Well, this car's got a lot of dents in it. It's not rusty, but it's got a lot of dents. The interior is, you know, average, but I call it a rat hot rod. So.
Now, let's go back to where do you feel like your game is the best at? Without giving away too many secrets.
Well, there ain't no secrets to it. I mean, one day I can come out here and kill the tree and then can't do nothing right at the finish line. And then the next time, you know, I'll do my job at the finish line and can't take care of the starting line. So, I mean, it's just all how I feel.
So is it safe to say that you really don't feel like you've got any expertise in one or the other out here on duty? It's just kind of a matter of what day it is?
It's a matter of how I'm feeling, how my head's in the game. It's just like any sport, you know. If your head's in it and you're concentrating, you know, you can't do nothing wrong.
In drag racing, it does take a lot of concentration.
Sure,
I mean, you got to – I mean, we're talking about in 10,000ths of a second or whatever.
Yeah.
I mean, when you're sitting there at that tree, that light goes 1, 2, 3 – And we're running off of, now they call it Pro Tree.
It's
and
a 500 full-sport.
And what's that between each light?
It's actually from the time the third amber light comes on, it's 0.500ths of a second, which is a half of a second, till the green light illuminates. Of course, you try to react to the third yellow light because time your brain tells you flip and the car actually moves, then the green light's coming on.
And it's so more complicated because that's not just it, folks. When them lights blink and you got that quick with time to react, I'm just now learning is like rolling into the light. You can roll in barely in, and that gives you a little more time to not red light. Then there's people rolls in deep because their cars are slow and they don't have throttle response. To me, there's just so many ways you can lose this thing.
Oh yeah.
And it's more about you than it is running the other guy.
Well, just like I just lost with an old 67 light. And you're talking 67, which is the 6 is a tenth, the thousandth of a second, and the 7 is a 10,000th of a second. So basically, I'm 6,000ths of a second late to the light. And I got drilled, you know.
Drilled. You're talking about that
drilled.
And it's just hard to believe that you would call that getting drilled. And it is.
It is.
Because it really looks, it shows me on the track a little bit.
Yeah, it shows up. You know, at 60,000ths is about probably 10, 15 feet down there at the other end.
And that's huge.
And that's huge.
Yeah. If you want it, I mean, the whole lot is be a really neck-to-neck race.
Yeah.
Now, you know, talking about rolling in, do you roll in deep or do you stay quiet?
No, I try to stay as shallow as I can because the car and me and everything will be more consistent if you can just barely shallow that second bulb.
And then it's true, too. Whatever you do, you need to do it every time the same. I mean, if you do deep, you need to do it deep every time so you can get consistent on how you need to do your car.
I mean, you know, it affects your light, obviously, but it also affects the car because you roll in deep, the car slows down. So if you got it dialed to be shallow and then you go in deep, you're already, you know.
So now, for the fans that don't know what you're talking about, if you go in deep, it's going to affect your ET time. Is that what you're talking about?
Yeah, exactly.
It's going to make it slower
on
the time.
Well, see, it's a foot between the two starting beams. So if you start at the start, you know, the first beam, and if you go in deep, you've lost a foot, a head start.
Yep.
You know, basically, in layman's terms, is the way it works.
So it just, I mean, again, it just keeps on adding and adding to the complication to the new guy like myself. Just keep on learning. You know, when I first went out there, I just rolled in wherever I wanted to roll in. And then I got to thinking, you know, how come my ET is so much different every time?
Exactly.
Well, it's because I'm going in different every
That's
time.
Exactly right.
So I have to learn to be more consistent in my car and where I feel better and where my car works better and do it every time.
Yep, that's the key.
And it's just amazing to me how complicated, but yet really simple once you start learning, that you just got to be, you got to do everything the same way every time.
Yeah, that's the main key. If you're beginning, just starting out, don't change nothing, good or bad. If you're doing bad, just keep doing consistent. And if you keep doing the same thing over and over, then change that one point.
And, you know, one of the things that I thought when I come here, it was always about, I want to be a fast car. And I was like, how many mile an hour? I was like, boy, car run 100 mile an hour. That car run 110 mile an hour. You don't hear drag racers talk about 110 mile an hour, 130. It's ET time.
ET.
You know, 6 second guy or 8 second guy.
Yeah.
So, you know, that's another thing I had to learn. It really doesn't matter, like you said.
No.
I mean, you can get beat by a car running 60 mile an hour out here if a guy is consistent gets off that line quick enough.
Exactly.
You know, he's doing it. Now, let me ask you this. We want to talk about you a little bit again.
All right.
What's one of the brightest moments in your drag racing time, an event you won or something that really sticks out in your mind that you are most happy about accomplishing?
Well, I've actually got a couple. The first one being I won a diesel world championship. I used to drive for TS Performance. I drove a diesel truck. And that year I went to Houston, Texas, won a world championship in a diesel bracket class.
Wow.
And that was a pretty good moment. And then I had a moment in Bristol, Tennessee. It was a, you know, it was a big race, had a lot of big names, and I wound up winning. Of course, got to be on ESPN and stuff. That's my first TV interview, so that was pretty cool. You know, that's awesome. That's my biggest one-day check, you know. So.
I didn't even realize that. Did you drove the diesel trucks for them guys out there?
I actually drove for them about 3 years.
Well, that's pretty awesome. Now, how is it with the diesels? I see them guys get out there and they sit there, and you know, we throw. And that's another thing. Let me ask you this first, though. When you get on the line, you hold your brake and you get the gas down. I heard some of them say they build up certain RPMs and everything. Because now we run, and I'm assuming you run too. What would they call it? I guess a brake car or something where you do it yourself and you don't have a.
I've got my white car, my white Regal set up. I can top bulb with a delay box. I got a trans brake, yes. Or I can trans brake it on the bottom bulb, or I foot brake it like what you do in your street car.
Right.
And that's just what I do in my wagon, foot brake.
Okay, now let's just go to your wagon then on foot brake. Do you try to build it? Does it have a tag for you?
Yep.
Do you try to build a certain RPM on that every time too?
I leave it the exact same RPM every time. And that's how I adjust my light.
And that keeps you from spinning too or whatever?
You set the car up not to spin. You know, obviously the torque converter is only going to let it go to a certain RPM. And, you know, you just adjust what you want to leave at, you know. But like if I'm, say I'm 005, three passes in a row, leaving at 2,000, I don't want to be that close to the red light.
Right.
So I'll back it up to like 1,700 and leave next pass. To slow the reaction time down a little bit.
So there you go, folks. Again, it's another thing about racing. I mean, I was talking to some guys. I haven't won a first pass yet. I've only run four races out here. And round track guy, and I want to win, you know.
Yeah.
And it seemed to me like, you know, I thought when I come over here, it'd be fairly easy. I just had it in my mind. And I want to win one pass. But I talked to some guys last night, said they'd raced like 2 years before they ever won their first pass. Several said they'd run like 10, 15 races before they won their first pass. Do you remember how long it took you to ever win your first pass?
To win my first pass, I actually done it the second time I came out.
Oh, we don't want to talk. Cut the camera.
But now, that I come out here, of course, I got Buicks. I come out to Buick Nationals weekend, and them guys ain't bracket racers on the most part. I ain't going to say all of them don't know how to drive, but for the most part. And I didn't have a clue what I was doing. That's the guy, he dialed my car for me. And he just said, just leave, you know, have good lights. And I never lifted, and I wound up going four rounds, believe it or not, that day. But then, actually, out here on Sunday with guys that know how to race, it took me about 2 years for I actually won a race. You know, I win rounds here and there, but it took me about 2 years for I actually won my first race.
I told him if I win one round, I'm going to climb the fence like Tony Stewart does. But then I don't know if Dallas's fence would hold me.
Some place is pretty raggedy,
But anyway, now, let me ask you this. You said the big events that you won, you mentioned that. What are you doing this year? Because I know some while ago you confused me. You run, I guess, Sportsman or something, and you run the trophy things, which is quarter-mile trophy. I know you run the O'Reilly's quarter-mile trophy on Saturday night. But I see you running around getting in different lanes and running different things. What all have you run today?
Today I just run Sportsman and Pro Bracket.
Okay.
Sportsman Pro, whatever. Usually run on Sunday. And then occasionally I'll bring my white car and run Super Pro. It just depends on how the mood strikes me.
Okay. Now, what are you doing this year's sports points?
O'Reilly's, of course, we run O'Reilly's on Saturday night. I wound up finishing second place in points to that, to Joey. Of course, he come out of the gate strong this year, and they just got a big lead. None of us could catch him. I'm actually second place in Sportsman, and I think I'm down around fifth or sixth in Pro Bracket.
Well, that's for a good 2 seconds and a fifth or sixth there. So that's pretty awesome there. Now, I know they have this as an NHRA sanction on Sundays.
Yeah.
And they have their banquet up in Indianapolis is what I heard, where this track's represented too. Do you ever go to that one or you just go to the beach?
I just usually go to the beach band banquet.
And I think somebody told me last year they had it at, down at Franklin at Kentucky Downs or whatever they call
sure
it.
Sure did.
Keep changing. Now, how is it to go to that event? Because I understand they put a pretty good little banquet on down there. Do you have a good time with that?
You talking about the beach band banquet?
Yeah, the beach
band. It's a fun event. I mean, you know, we all get together for once. We're not
prizes.
In competition. You know, we all sit around and BS and, you know, and tell lies. And
tell how what you're going to do next
year.
What
we're going to do,
You already done tell them you're going to be the fastest car.
Oh, yeah.
Car
you well, know, we've done made cards. You're not going to beat it next year. You know, it's
so
all changed.
It
yeah.
Now, you know, with the economy, we talk about that almost every show. We've seen in the stock cars, and I don't know much about this drag, like I said again, but it appears sometimes the car count's a little thin. I know on some of the big events, they've actually the car count's been up, actually. Last week or week before last when they done the Lucas Oil, he said they had a pretty good little rise in car count. But now, on O'Reilly's, I've been hearing that some of the guys say the car count's getting a little thin on the O'Reilly shootout night. You think that's because of the economy and the gas prices?
Well, that's part of it, yeah. I mean, of course, O'Reilly's don't pay no money. It's a trophy. Of course, you get some points money at the end of the year.
Right.
But there's most of the guys is not going to beat on a good car for a trophy, you know. It's like my white car, you know.
It's a fun event.
Yeah, it's made to have fun and learn how to do it. For beginners, that's the place to come. You know, you learn how to drag a race. But, yeah, the economy is hard. I mean, I used to go to Nashville every Saturday night instead of out here. But gas money, you know, it's just cheaper for me to come out here and have fun than go to the hill every Saturday night now.
Well, now, what do you see in the future if things don't change, if it keeps getting like it? Do you think that it's going to hurt the drag racing that much more, or do you think things are going to bounce back around? What's your opinion on it?
I mean, things obviously is probably going to bounce back. But as long as gas stays cheaper like it's been, I'm sure we'll be okay. Gas prices, in my opinion, is the biggest cause of it.
Now, what about all this? I know NASCAR. I follow it because, like I said, and I've started watching the drags. I told somebody today that drag guys were a lot more fun and had a better time. And then we started watching and seeing John Force whoop somebody on TV. I said, well, I guess they fight a little bit in drag races too. But my thing is NASCAR's talking about going to all fuel injection and getting away from built motors. That's something they're looking at doing here maybe in the next year or so. What do you think about that in maybe drags? Do you think it'll ever come to that? I mean, with EPA and the air and all that kind of thing, and then even just as far as like, I mean, can Holly or a lot of these other quick fuel, can they keep building these carburetors if all the new cars come out is fuel injection?
Well, obviously, fuel injection is going to happen. I mean, you know, like stock
front-wheel drive cars.
Yeah, it's going to happen. Stock cars, you know, it's supposed to be a stock car. It's like Warren Johnson's been saying it for years. Hey, you know, pro stock, we need to be running fuel injection.
Right.
Stock cars has got them on it. But now as far as bracket cars, you know, yeah, I'd say probably in the distant future, I could see EPA making changes to everybody. But, I mean, it's going to be probably years for that happens.
Yeah, I figured it'd be off, but I know the buzz, the talk, they're talking about a lot of this stuff in racing. And, you know, that's one of my things that I've wondered about. Is there anything that any bad times? Now, we always talk about the good things, but have you ever had any close calls, any bad wrecks? I mean, flipped a car or done anything?
No.
Anytime it scares you out there?
I've never had a wreck, period. I have got crossed up and crossed lanes before, but you know, never was scared at no point. But I mean, it was right on the starting line.
Need to put you in a stock car then. We need to take you out here.
Now, that's a different story.
We'll put you in the figure eight. Now, this, by the time this is going to be over, we're having the big figure eight racer traveling series come here. We'll put you in there and put Big Ed on the side of it and let you go through that exit about 90 miles.
I don't want no part of that.
That's another reason I want to come over here and drag race. It is a little safer. It seems to me,
well,
anyway.
You ain't got 43 other cars on there with you. You know, worst scenario case, you're going to hit one other car.
And the thing about it is, when we get beaten on each other here, if they don't hurt you on the track, they take you to piss and we'll finish it over.
That's exactly right.
But anyway, now, what about sponsorship? Do you have any sponsors, anybody out there that you'd like to thank and tell the fans a little bit about sponsorship?
My main sponsor would be Waltz Transmission, which is my employer. He's the main guy that helps me. You know, he gives me time off with pay. He gives me parts. You know, you name it. If he's got it, I can get it.
Like we might need a rear end.
Yeah, he is going to get me a rear end. I've done made my phone call. He's got it laying on the counter. Yeah. Of course, TS Performance still helps me. I don't drive for him, but he still helps me with some entry fee monies and, you know, loaning the trucks. So.
And that's the good thing. And, you know, even now, I know stock car guys have a lot of their sponsors on their cars. I don't see a lot of them on the drag cars or maybe the little bitty. But now, even in drag racing, it's really important out there to have the community help us out and sponsorship
exactly.
Stuff to be able to race these races. Because a lot of times, I mean, you know, now like the Saturday night thing I'm doing, it's not all that much. But if you travel or do a lot of competition thing, it can get pretty expensive with entry fees and fuel and tires. And that's another. How long, if you're running a series like you're running in some of the bigger classes, about how long does those tires usually wear for you that and do a good job?
Well, my white car, I'll average about 250 to 270 passes, which is usually I get two sets of tires a year. Now, my wagon, of course, it's slower. I don't do near the burnout. I can get a whole year on them, usually about 400 to 500 passes. So.
But, you know, your oil changes, just everything, and then torque conversion, or whatever you tear up every once in a while. So it's good to have sponsors out there.
Yeah.
And, you know, folks, I'd like to say this to the community out there. we need sponsors for our show, and we need you guys to get involved with a lot of people. I think Bowling Green's listening to our show and the other shows don't realize really what is that beach being. A lot of people lives right here. Bowling Green's never been here.
Exactly.
And it's a great family event. You can come out here. I've seen people bring little grills out, cook out, and spend a day with their family and do things like that. And by the way, Do you have a family? I don't know you that well, so I guess I'll put you on the spot here, but I guess you got a family.
Well, I'm dating a girl. She's got a little boy.
No, that's the same thing.
But yeah, we're family, you know, as close as you can be without legally.
Well, I thought I saw you. There was a young lady here one night on a Saturday night and a child there, so I thought it was. Well, listen, Earl, our time's about run out, man. We appreciate you taking time out. And we got some clips we're going to show of you going down the strip, and that's in your famous wagon that we all talk about here. Wish you good luck the rest of the year. Hope you do real good and coming up next year. And if I race you sometime, that's on time. I hope you lose one.
All right,
we'll see you later. Thanks for being on the show.
Okay,
folks, we want to say, first of all, we want to thank Big Earl for the time that he allowed to take out of his busy schedule of drag racing. He's out here actually beach being drag racing as we were talking this. So, Big Earl, we appreciate you taking that time out. Now, let's talk a little bit about, as we said at the beginning of the show, the schedule for this weekend. As we said earlier last week, there's no more stock car racing until April of 2000, and that's when the 2010 schedule will start back in April. Now, this weekend, though, man, have we got on tap a great weekend for you. It's the Ford Nationals NMRA, the number one all-Ford auto show in the USA. This week, October the 1st through the 4th, and that's Thursday through Sunday. Folks, this is an absolutely great show to be to go to. Even if you're a Chevrolet guy, you'll enjoy seeing this. Now, I see our time's about come and gone. We're not having a giveaway again this week. We'll hopefully start back next week on doing our giveaway. But right now, we want to say the views and expression on this show is not necessarily that of our sponsor or the station. And we'd like to say, if you're watching this for the first time, we're glad to have you. Glad you let us come into your home. Be sure to tell a friend, tell a neighbor. And remember this, we're on every Monday night at 7:30 on Insight Cable Channel 5. Until next Monday night, I'm Odell Turner, your host, saying, have a good night. We'll see you then. It's high.